morning, everyone. The sun is shining, so it's one good thing about today. But another good thing about today is our speaker. So welcome to Skedumpha Library and Chats with Champions. Chats has a 15-year history of presenting programs that span the interests of all the segments of our community. Our next chat is Tuesday, May 16th, when nationally noted artist John Wally will talk about his creative process and share images of his recent book. Chats is sponsored by Sherman's Maine Coast Bookshop. 100 years ago this spring, America entered World War I. With the same patriotic fervor that Maine had responded for the call of troops for the Civil War, 35,000 men and women across the state joined the military in 1917 to 1918 to fight in the war to end all wars and the war that promised to make the world safe for democracy. Today, Earl G. Shuttleworth, Jr., Maine State Historian, a position he has held since 2004, will present an illustrated lecture that documents the role played by Maine men and women in World War I, especially here at home. A native of Portland, Maine, Shuttleworth attended Deering High School, Colby College, and Boston University, and was recipient of an honorary doctorate from both Bowdoin College and the Maine College of Art. At the age of 13, he became interested in historic preservation through the destruction of Portland's Union Station in 1961. A year later, he joined the Sills Committee, which founded Greater Portland Landmarks. In 1971, he was appointed by Governor Curtis to serve on the first board of the Maine Historic Preservation Commission, for which he became architectural historian in 1973 and director in 1976. He retired from that position in 2015. He has lectured and written extensively on Maine history and architecture, and his most recent publication being Maine Photography, A History from 1840 to 2015, which he co-authored in 2015. It's my pleasure to introduce Earl Shuttleworth.
I want to thank you all for coming on this beautiful morning, and I want to assure you that I think we're all off to a great tourist season, because there is already a bottleneck in Wiscasset this week. So that's very encouraging for May 4th. No, I had a little time going through the village, which is always nice because you can get a look at the houses. And then the bridge was nice too. So, in any case, well, as has already been mentioned, we're now really deep into the 100th anniversary of World War I. World War I actually broke out in Europe in August of 1914, but it was a period of several years before America joined the war. And indeed, the election of 1916 was literally fought over that issue of whether with Woodrow Wilson we would stay out of the war, or whether with Charles Evan Hughes we would enter the war. And Wilson was very reluctant to have America participate in the European war, but ultimately in 1917, a number of matters came together. The Germans, early in 1917, declared that all vessels on the high seas were subject to their torpedoing, and that included American vessels. And so we began to see, and I read some of the old newspapers, and you have these terrible, glaring headlines of American vessels or vessels with Americans on them being torpedoed and beginning to have a large loss of life in that regard. And then there was also the issue of Mexico where we had already had border difficulties in 1916, and there was the threat that there would be an alliance between Germany and Mexico, with, if the Germans were successful in the war, they would then have Mexico take back the Southwest. And that didn't sit too well with us also. So April 6th, Wilson declares war. It's a very brief period, relatively speaking. We're in the war from April of 1917 until the armistice, you know, the famous 11th month, 11th day, 11th hour in 1918 when the war ends. So it's about a 19-month period. And during that period, it has already been mentioned, about 35,000 men and women from Maine participated in the war effort in the military. But many more participated on the home front. And that's really our story this morning, is to show largely through old photographs, and of those photographs, largely through old photographic postcards, or what we call today real photo postcards, the story of what Maine men, women, and children did on the home front in that 19-month period between 1917 and 18. So we start with this very unlikely photograph, and I'm now going to sit down and hide behind the podium here so that you can concentrate on the photographs. But also, maybe just a couple ground rules that I forgot to mention. One is that if you have a cell phone, would you please turn it off? If you're in a legislative hearing in Augusta now, they'll fine you $5 if your cell phone goes off. And that'd be an awfully good way to make money for the Skidoffa Library. Nothing official, but just a minor veil threat. And then the other thing is, if you would hold your questions until the end, I'm very happy to field any questions or any comments that you have as well. So we start with downtown Portland. We start with Monument Square and the Civil War Monument that's still there today in Monument Square. But here in front of the monument around 1916 is an unlikely sight, a tent that says walk-in, has the British flag on it, British Canadian Recruiting Office. Now, officially, Americans were not supposed to be joining foreign armies, but America kind of looked the other way between 1914 and 1917 in that regard, and there were quite a few men from Maine, particularly those in northern Maine, where the border was maybe a little vague up there as to what was Canada and what was Maine, were involved particularly in joining the Canadian Army. And then there were British and Canadian citizens who were working in Maine who joined as well. This then gave way, as we'll see, when the war opened, to an entirely different arrangement in Monument Square. Here we have Woodrow Wilson with the American flag. Wilson came to prominence in America, first as president of Princeton University, then as governor of New Jersey, and then he won the very heated three-way election of 1912, in which William Howard Taft was running for a second term. Teddy Roosevelt decided he wanted a third term and ran on the Bull Moose ticket. And the Republican votes divided, and Wilson got in as president, and then was reelected in 1916 on the platform of "He kept us out of war." So when the war opens, the Maine military is set up much the way it had been during the Civil War, with local units that had, during the Spanish American War period, moved from strictly state units into sort of quasi-state federal units that were National Guard units. And so these National Guard units located all over the state were mobilized. At the same time, a big recruiting effort took place. And this is a homegrown Maine poster. You've got it to do it. Why not start now? This man is a volunteer, a measure of Maine's patriotism. Very quick, Massachusetts. Here we see World War I boys going to the train in 1917. This is the troops marching down to the railroad station in Farmington. Here's the massing of troops from Central Maine. This was the company that was stationed in Dexter, and the troops are there right by the track waiting for the train, and then there are large numbers of their family and friends to see them off. Here's a similar photograph taken in September of 1917, where the troops have already boarded the train, mobilization scene in Belfast. Now, most of the troop trains had to pass through the Great Union Station in Portland. This was really the railroad hub. And as they did, and they slowed down or they stopped for a few minutes, the Red Cross workers, the ladies in their white uniforms, would come out and give the troops boxes of cigarettes, candy, newspapers, sandwiches, whatever. And these are a couple of photographs of troop trains heading south with Red Cross workers on the platform in Union Station in 1917. Some of the troops were trained in much more remote locations. This is a group of men, several of them from Waterville, who were trained in the Signal Corps at Camp Drum in Plattsburgh, New York, upstate New York. And there were the parades all over Maine, the great patriotic parades. This is the parade down Main Street in Biddeford. Here is actually what was called a preparedness parade, because of course we knew as we were moving toward through March toward April of 1917 that war was probably going to break out. And this is a parade in March of 1917 on Congress Street in Portland. Big building, sort of center left, the one farthest back, is the old Porteous Mitchell and Braun department store that's now the Maine College of Art. And here is another parade in Portland once the war has started. And the troops that are marching in Monument Square were called the Milliken Regiment. This was one of the regiments that ultimately morphed into the 26th, which was the famous Yankee Division where all the troops came from New England. And the Yankee Division was actually the first division to touch the shores in France and the first to be in the field. Milliken because from 1917 to 1921, our governor was Carl E. Milliken. We'll catch a sight of him later on. But Carl Milliken was everywhere. And early on, he adopted a kind of uniform of his own in which, at every public event, he was dressed in a long tail coat and a tall silk hat, so you couldn't miss who was the governor. One of the great efforts in the war by the US government was to involve the populace through the loan and savings stamp programs. In other words, a big chunk of the war was actually financed by the loans of the populace. And this is a Liberty Loan parade on Cumberland Avenue in Portland, about 1918. And there's a tank. Of course, the tank, like the airplane, one of the new weapons of war that's introduced in World War I. The Liberty Loan effort was highly successful in Maine, as it was across the country. By the time the war was over, Maine people had bought $118 million worth of bonds and $8 million worth of stamps, and the stamps were mainly bought by the school children. And the pro rata was $147 donated by each man, woman, and child in Maine for the war. On May 8th, 1917, there was a huge Kennebec Valley parade down Water Street in Augusta. Here is one of the views, the big American flag being carried in front of the old post office in Augusta that's still standing. And here, just to give you a sense of the numbers of people who turned out for these events, this is the May 8th Augusta Parade in 1917, just 100 years ago, 8,000 to 10,000 people turned out for this parade. In Hollowell, where I live, there were 2,000 people living in Hollowell in 1917, and it was estimated that 800 out of the 2,000 people in Hollowell attended this parade. Here are troops marching up State Street in Bangor. There were huge parades in Bangor. This is the University of Maine Regiment. From the time that the university was formed as a land-grant college in 1865, there had been a kind of quasi-ROTC military training program there, so there already was a kind of quasi-military unit attached to the university. And in fact, in the early days of the war, all 20 members of the university band volunteered for the war. Another very important part of the Maine Front was the Red Cross. The Red Cross existed in part to roll bandages and to amass medical supplies. They actually were active prior to America's entering the war. They sent lots of supplies over to France for the French and English armies. But once America was in the war, of course, they focused their effort on our army. And here is a Red Cross parade, June 29, 1918. It's estimated that in the Bangor Brewer area during the war, about 1,200 women volunteered for the Red Cross. They also, of course, raised money, which again was sent over to France and allowed for assistance with hospitals and with a lot of the supplies that the men needed. Now, there was a naval presence along the coast during World War I. There were various naval stations that were manned, and here we see evidence of that in a naval parade on April 29, 1918, on the little island of Vinalhaven, out there about 10 miles out into the ocean from Rockland. And these are naval troops that have come over to assist with that parade. So this is what happened to the British Canadian recruiting station. It turned into a Maine log cabin. It was replaced by a log cabin in Monument Square in Portland. And this was the Portland headquarters for the War Savings Stamp effort. And so if you wanted to buy a bond or if you wanted to buy stamps, you came here. And of course, the stamps were also sold in the schools as well. There were also lots of different approaches to raising money for the war effort and getting people to commit to the bonds and the stamps. Here we're in Searsport on the main street, and this is a Browning machine gun that was put on a mobile unit, and just they drove up and down the coast to all the towns as part of a war savings stamp drive in 1918, and the sign says, "Buy 20 war saving stamps, we'll put this gun on the battlefront." Here's a large combination war saving stamp and Red Cross rally in Skowhegan in 1917. And here a photograph of the Marine Hardware Equipment Company on the waterfront of South Portland. They were a foundry that made brass and iron parts for vessels, and actually there was a lot of shipbuilding going on in Portland Harbor as part of the war effort. But this is a photo taken in October of 1918, which proudly proclaims, "In the fourth Liberty Loan, every employee in this company has subscribed for the Liberty Loan." Now the children, of course, got into the act as well. Here in that big Red Cross parade that we saw a few moments ago in June of 1918, we see a group of Bangor Brewer girls dressed in white dresses, sort of quasi Red Cross outfits. And here are the little boys, they are in probably what were actually Boy Scout uniforms, because the Boy Scout uniforms and the 1917-18 Army uniforms were almost interchangeable. And you see there's one representative of the Navy up front there. Not too much naval action up in Bangor. Now, they're carrying little Tommy guns, but in another parade, the newspaper said that they actually carried shovels and hoes to promote the idea that they were helping their parents with their home victory gardens. Here's a row of young men who are Boy Scouts from Lincoln. And again, I just show this to underscore the fact that there was very little difference between the Boy Scout uniforms and the Army uniforms, period. Here, of course, the war effort made its way into the schools. I've already mentioned that the war savings stamps were sold in the schools. But here is a pageant in Hollowell in one of the classrooms in which there's a very young-looking Uncle Sam at the center, flanked by two young Army men. Mostly, there are Red Cross girls in this class, and also there's a couple stray naval young men as well. Now, symbolism was very important during the war. There was really incredible public relations development. I've mentioned it already with the recruiting posters, and there were many other different posters as well. It's in this war that the symbolism of the star represents service. This is a postcard sent out to all the members of the First Baptist Church in Portland. And the blue star with the 65, and it means that 65 members of the church are participating in the war. Here is a case where the blue star is used for advertising purposes to let the patrons of Lauren Shorten Harmon, which was a book and stationery store in Portland, know that this number of men, this number of blue stars from their staff were serving in the military, and please be patient with us because we just don't have as many people in our store serving you as we used to. Here's probably one of the great pieces of Maine propaganda from the war. Eat more potatoes and save the wheat, Maine Potato Week. This is April 28th to May 4th. This is May 4th, this is 99 years ago, this poster was issued. Governor Milliken issued an order for Maine Potato Week that people would substitute potatoes for wheat. Every potato you eat is a bullet fired point blank at a Made in Germany piece. So you can even throw potatoes at the enemy. And here, this poor beast has been harnessed to this piece of farm equipment. This is a July 4th parade in Monmouth in 1918, in which we're proclaiming raise more beef. Artists from Maine got involved. Mildred Burridge, who of course in the latter part of her life lived in Wiscasset, but she was living in Kennebunkport at the time. She did a series of studies for war posters. They were not actually printed, but some of these studies survive. This is a beautiful one she did for the Red Cross, in which the Maine pine tree straddles the world. It's decked with the flags of the Allies, and then over it flies the flag of the Red Cross. Anyone want to take a guess at who this might be? No, she's a little bit of a Civil War. This is Margaret J. Smith. She's 20 years old in 1917. And she's a Red Cross volunteer at Skowhegan. So she early on, she got into public life. Here's a series of three photographs that I think are fascinating. These were taken in 1915. This is 2 years before we enter the war, but Americans are already very much wanting to support the English and the French armies. These ladies are a combination of local year-round ladies from Seal Harbor and their summer counterparts. And they are meeting in the community house in Seal Harbor under the aegis of this gentleman at the far right, who's Dr. Edward Dunham, who's also a commissioned officer in the medical corps as well. And he is teaching them how to make bandages, roll bandages. And then you can see the box in the foreground. And these bandages are then sent to French hospitals.
Living at Martha's house?
No. It hadn't been built yet.
Right.
That comes another 10 years later. Now, here is one of the summer employees of the Dunham family in their big cottage. And she's, you know, getting the yarn ready for knitting. You can already see the socks. In the summer of 1915, the ladies of Seal Harbor knitted 500 pairs of wool socks for the French troops. And then these are what we would call today euphemistically care packages. This is Mrs. Dunham at the left and her daughter, who are bringing together these packages that would have, you know, gum and candy and writing paper and whatever that would also be sent to the French troops and the French hospitals. And actually, the Dunham daughter, very shortly after this photo was taken, went over and volunteered in the French hospitals. And there were quite a few Americans who went over and volunteered in the French ambulance corps before the war broke out. Of course, one of the famous ones was Waldo Pierce, the artist. And it was at that time that he first befriended Ernest Hemingway, who was also in the ambulance corps. Now, on the home front, of course, many jobs in industry are vacated by men who have gone to the military. And unlike our previous American wars, the Civil War, the Spanish-American War, these industrial positions are now being filled with women. Now, it's not that women hadn't been in the workforce in Maine since the beginning, and they indeed were a very important part of the workforce in the textile mills and in the shoe factories. But now they were even more so. And these ladies, who look like they're part of a Red Cross parade, are actually employees of the Cummings Shoe Factory in South Berwick in 1917. And they are proudly marching in a parade that proclaims the fact that they are working in the shoe factory for the war effort. Many Maine industries provided goods and services to the war effort, including, of course, textiles and shoes. One of the riskiest things that Maine women did during the war was the assembly of shells. And here we have, at the Portland Company, which was a foundry on the waterfront in Portland, women actually assembling these large artillery shells. Of course, Maine, with its wonderful Great Coastline, was a natural for shipbuilding. The long tradition going back to the first ship in America, we believe, being built at the mouth of the Kennebec in 1607. Here we have the launching of the first submarine built at the Portsmouth Naval Shipyard. Now, the Portsmouth Naval Shipyard was founded in 1800. It is our oldest active shipyard, still 217 years later, very active for the Navy. But here, coming out of the old Franklin shiphouse, which was built for the assembly of Civil War vessels, is the launching of the first submarines. And this really helped establish Portsmouth as a submarine base center, which it still is today. There was also a big push by the government for the construction by private industry of transport vessels, convoy vessels. And there were quite a few of them built along the Maine coast. These were usually just simple, large wooden vessels. They were the precursors of the iron Liberty ships, the steel Liberty ships of World War II. So we have the Portland Ship Sealing Company request the honor of your presence at the launching of the Andrea, the first ship constructed for the Emergency Fleet Corporation. That was what the government agency was called that coordinated the construction of all these convoy vessels. Now, there's a kind of an interesting postscript to this. The vessel was supposed to be launched on Saturday, April 20th. All the dignitaries were there, including Governor Milliken in his tall silk hat. However, you've heard the term grease the skids. Well, it was still very cold in April of 1918, and the grease on the skids froze, and the vessel, they couldn't get the vessel launched until the weather moderated a few days later. However, here is one of these big convoy vessels that was built in another shipyard. Russell Shipyard was off the Eastern Promenade in Portland. This is one of the Southport shipyards. And there were a large number of these built, nowhere near as large though as the Liberty ships. There were over 250 Liberty ships built in the South Portland yards in World War II between 1942 and 1945. Bath Iron Works, of course, had received naval contracts since as early as 1890, and so it's no surprise to find them building destroyers for the Navy. Here's a four-stack destroyer being launched during World War I at Bath. And of course, no one had any idea how long the war was going to last. And so as a result, there was so much shipbuilding activity going on at the Bath Iron Works that the Emergency Fleet Corporation decided that they would build two new neighborhoods for shipbuilders and their families. They built a brick neighborhood in the north part of Bath and a wooden neighborhood more south, near where Route 1 is now. And the irony is that these very nice little houses, whether they were brick or wooden, were actually not completed before the war ended. And so then they were just sold on the open market. And many shipbuilding families didn't end up buying them. And there was shipbuilding activity related to the war for two or three years afterwards. Here's one of the wonderful, perhaps lesser-known stories of the war. This is the liner Crown Princess Cecily. And she is in Bar Harbor in August of 1914. The story is that she left New York Harbor, bound for Germany. She was a German vessel. The war broke out, and she was going to pass through British waters. And so she realized that she would be captured. And so her captain turned her back to America, which was then neutral. There happened to be several of the summer folk from Bar Harbor on the vessel. And one of them convinced the captain that the closest port was Bar Harbor. And so rather than returning to New York, the great vessel glided into Bar Harbor one morning, and then you see the little local steamer coming up, you know, to bring people to disembark. There are some wonderful stories about this. One is that, whether it's true or not, one of the summer ladies from Bar Harbor woke up that summer morning, opened her porthole, and looked out and saw her summer cottage. Whether that's true or not, I don't know. But anyway, so what happened to the vessel? Well, even though we were not technically at war with Germany, everybody was disembarked and allowed to go where they needed to go. But the vessel was seized by the United States government, and it was held all during the neutral period. And then it was actually formally seized in 1917 and used as a troop ship. There also was a real prize on board, $10 million in German gold, $1 million in silver. And the government also took a long-term loan out of that as well. Here's a smaller vessel, but one that shows that when the war broke out, there was a call by the Navy for vessels of all sizes to be used for various purposes, including patrol boats. Cyrus H.K. Curtis, the famous publisher of the Saturday Evening Post and the Ladies' Home Journal, was an extraordinarily wealthy and also patriotic man. He was born in Portland in 1839, and he ended up living in the Philadelphia area for his publishing career. But he loved Maine, and in 1903, he and his son-in-law, Edward Bach, built summer cottages at Beauchamp Point in Rockport. In 1907, he commissioned the first Lindonia, this beautiful white yacht. so that he didn't have to train from Philadelphia to Maine. Rather, he could go in style along the coast and then go back again at the end of the summer. But when the war broke out, he donated the Lindonia to the Navy. And she did survive the war, but by that time Curtis decided, well, I probably need a larger Lindonia. So he built Lindonia too. Now, I've mentioned about how important Maine was for shipbuilding during the war. We were also, of course, very important economically, because the Port of Portland was a key connection to Canada. Goods would come in and out, and then connect by rail to go to Canada or to ship out of Canada. In addition, Bangor was very important as well, because of the continuing lumber industry. So particularly in Portland Harbor, the old forts that had gone back, some of them as far as the Revolution and the War of 1812, they were beefed up for the war. And here we see troops training at Fort Williams, which had been established at the time of the Spanish-American War in 1898. And they are part of what was known as the Coastal Artillery Corps. And there was a large presence in Portland Harbor of the Coastal Artillery. There were gun emplacements at Fort Williams, Fort Leavitt on Cushing Island, Fort McKinley on Diamond Island, and Fort Preble in South Portland. And here we have the disappearing gun. So if you're the German warship coming into Portland Harbor, you really can't see this gun until it fires at you. There we go. Here's one of the barracks at Fort McKinley. And many of these views that I'll just mention again are actually these real photo postcards that were actually sent by people who were there at the time. And in this particular case, this view was sent in 1917 from a private named Harry Harmon, who writes simply to his family, "I'm having a good time." So now we're going to quickly go through some of the faces of the war, some of whom we know, some of whom we don't. This is a real photo postcard taken of a young soldier in the Alexander Studio in Portland. And these real photo postcards, of course, were very popular as souvenirs to send to family and friends, as images of yourself in the military. We don't know who this young man is, but we know he was in Portland. In each American war, immigrants have played a very important role. And in this case, we're looking at Charles Pappas at the right, who was a Greek immigrant who enlisted in the army from Lewiston. Here's a real throwback to the Civil War. This is a young soldier named James Lacy. His photograph, which becomes a real photo postcard, is taken out in the field. He's standing on grass or dirt, and there's a makeshift backdrop that's just painted with tents and a flag on the back. Very much the kind of thing you would have had in a Civil War camp studio. Here's a young soldier from Springvale. Sorry, I don't have his name, but we have been able to trace him with his younger brother and sister, and he actually lost his life in the war. There were about 1,000 casualties. Out of the 35,000 who participated in Maine, there were about 1,000 casualties from Maine during the war, combination of disease and also loss on the battlefield. Once you arrived in France, you could get to send this very simple postcard home. Ensign Walter Dickey was from Northport, and he just simply wrote, "The ship on," it says, "The ship on which I have sailed has arrived safely. Best wishes to all." If you were in France, you had an opportunity to buy one of these wonderful sort of little woven, embroidered slip cases for the real photo postcard of yourself. And this was the case, so to speak, with Private Bruce McLean, who was from Waite, Maine, in Washington County. And he wrote, sent this to his sister, and he wrote, as they often did, "From somewhere in France to my dear sister Dora." Here are young men from the Westbrook area in France in 1918. And the war ended, as we've already said, on November 11th, 1918. However, many thousands of American troops continued to be stationed in France and Germany as occupation troops for at least another year or two. And these are two young men from Maine who are enjoying rest and recreation on one of the southern French beaches. They've got this photograph taken. You can see the pine tree in the back.
Yeah.
And then we have a young sailor. This is also taken in a studio in Portland. Then we have some people that we know more about and maybe played a little more prominent role. This family group is the Richards family from Gardner. At the left, we have John Richards, who was an officer during the war. John Richards was the son of Laura E. Richards, the lady in the center, who was in turn the daughter of Julia Ward Howe, who wrote The Battle of the Republic. And Laura E. Richards lived most of her life in Gardner. She was a prolific children's authoress. She wrote over 90 children's books, including Captain January, which some of us will remember was turned into a movie with Shirley Temple. We're not really that old, but you know, we do remember those things. And then at the upper right is his father, Henry Richards, who was a distinguished architect and also ran one of the family businesses, a paper mill in Gardner. Now, one of the interesting things about John Richards is that he was badly wounded toward the end of the war, and then he was assigned as an officer to the Black Harlem Regiment. Of course, in those days, the officers of the black units were white, as they had been in the Civil War. And so he served with that regiment for several months. Now, the war is not so far away in time that, and I want to talk with you about this in the question and answer period, that there are not people that we knew. No one is now living who fought in the war, but there are many people in themselves who remember people who were involved in the war. And in this case, this is a man I knew when he was quite old and I was quite young, named Lieutenant Ben Stinchfield of Farmington Falls. Ben Stinchfield was extremely well-educated and extremely gifted in linguistics, and he was quickly assigned. First, he was going to go to General Pershing's headquarters in France to do translation, but then his orders were rerouted to the American Expeditionary Force to Siberia. And he served for about a year there as a translator. It's a little-known chapter. President Wilson sent about 8,000 American troops to Siberia, which sort of got us off on the bad foot with the Bolsheviks or the communists or whatever, because they didn't like the idea that we're on their territory. But the idea was to both protect the armaments that we'd already sent to Russia and also to protect some Polish troops as well. Serving with, and he remembered him very well, serving with Lieutenant Stinchfield was Captain K.L. Roberts, otherwise known as Kenneth L. Roberts, the novelist. And this is his trunk stencil, which is a fascinating relic. Roberts went not so much for the linguistics as he actually was a correspondent for some of the magazines. And so he got a commission and reported back. And this very serious looking young man is Walter Goodwin Davis from Portland, who again, in his old age and in my youth, I knew him, died in 1966. Again, like Ben Stinchfield, very well educated, went to both Harvard and Yale, and I think it was Yale undergraduate, Harvard Law School, volunteered, was commissioned, sent to the diplomatic legation in Switzerland during the war, and then was assigned to President Wilson's peace delegation at Versailles, and went on a special mission to interview the military and political leaders of the former countries of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire to gather information for Wilson for the peace treaty. Sadly, of course, as we've mentioned, about 1,000 Maine citizens did not return. And here's a sobering World War I funeral in Rumford. When the war ended, the parades began again. Here's the great Welcome Home Parade in Bangor, May 27, 1919, and nothing changes. The banner in the foreground at the right says, "Help get them a job." Now we catch a glimpse from the back, at least, of Governor Milliken. You can see his tails on his coat. He's the third figure in from the right. He is accepting the returned Maine battle flags, which is a long tradition in Maine military history. And those flags are still on display in the Hall of Flags at the State House. As the war ended, the troops returned and were gratefully celebrated. These are all the young men from the St. Augustine Franco-American Catholic Parish in Augusta. There was a special service in the spring of 1919 to honor them. And up and down Maine were these honor rolls, which had actually, some of them had been erected during the war, listing the people who were in service. And of course, if there was a gold star, which there are two on this one, it means that the individual had been lost in service. The honor roll in Lewiston was huge, 16 columns long, and shown on the common, which is now Kennedy Park. When the war ended, there were many efforts made to make more permanent memorials. Old Route 1 was the way in which people entered Maine in those days by automobile. And in 1920 to 23, the states of New Hampshire and Maine built what was then a state-of-the-art suspension bridge across the Scatapa River and used it to honor the troops from both states. Those plaques with the eagle were both on entrances on both sides. This is the Portsmouth side, there's also the Kittery side. And when this bridge was rebuilt recently, there was a great hue and cry in the southern part of New Hampshire and Maine to make sure that when it was rebuilt, those plaques went back on again, and they did. As you left the bridge and headed north on Route 1, from 1924 on, you were greeted by the official State of Maine Soldiers and Sailors Memorial. And this memorial, which still stands today at John Paul Jones Park in Kittery, is probably unlike almost any other war memorial, not only in Maine, but in America. For it was created under the guidance of Governor Percival P. Baxter. And Baxter was a very outspoken individual, very clear in his beliefs. He was very supportive of the war, but he also wanted people to remember the horrors of war. And so he found a young Czechoslovakian sculptress to create this great bronze relief panel of a mother cradling her child. Two writhing bodies, probably lost in battle, and a group of troops marching toward the trenches. Here's a close-up of it. Baska Paev was the young woman who created this. And there was a lot of controversy about it, but Baxter said, "I want people to remember in the future the horror of war." And this is very much related, actually, I think, in artistic inspiration to Goya's The Horrors of War, that series of remarkable engravings that he did. More conventional, but beautifully done, were the plaques and the monuments that went up in small towns all over Maine. Here in Palmyra, in central Maine, one of the most beautiful bronze reliefs, the doughboy in the center, at the right, the Civil War soldier, at the left, the Revolutionary War soldier. Here, the statue of the soldier in Memorial Park in Augusta, with his head bowed, looking at the grave of a compatriot. In the background, the Civil War memorial. Here, a more upbeat memorial. This is sort of like a great figure of victory, done by Charles Teft, a sculptor who had come from the Bangor Brewer area. This was dedicated just in time for the next war in 1939, sort of a victory holding torches and a laurel leaf. Here, an arch in Farmington, and an artillery piece, a German artillery, captured artillery piece in Holton, and in the background, the Civil War monument. Here, the Doughboy, the American Doughboy statue, which is actually found all over America. You can go online and there's a map that shows where there were multiple copies of this cast. The only one in Maine made its way up to the small community of Lincoln in northern Maine and was dedicated in 1927. And here I think very poignant, one man lost from Swansville, and his compatriots from the Army and the Navy assemble to dedicate his memorial, the Curtis Road to Clarence W. Curtis, in 1919. So, Americans and Mainers fought the Great War. As was mentioned in the introduction, it was the war to end all wars, the war to make safe for democracy. Sadly, it's very easy to just simplify and gloss over this historically, but for whatever reasons, the peace did not hold. And within a matter of another 20 years or so, we were back at war, fighting World War II. In many ways, World War I was kind of a blueprint for World War II, especially for the way government interacted with the citizenry in the home front. And then, of course, from there, we have had the uneasy peace ever since. So that's a little look back at what was going on in Maine 100 years ago. Thank you.